गाइस, दिस इज आमिर एंड टुडे वी हैव डॉक्टर रोया रोजाटी, वन ऑफ द फेमस इनफर्टिलिटी स्पेशलिस्ट इन हैदराबाद. सो टुडे शी इज गोना टॉक अबाउट मेल इनफर्टिलिटी एंड यू नो द क्योर फॉर इट. सो लेट्स हियर व्हाट डॉक्टर वांट्स टू से.
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग आमिर एंड वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल आवर ऑडियंस हु आर वाचिंग दिस क्लिप. एंड व्हाट डू यू वांट मी टू टॉक अबाउट आमिर? व्हाट आर योर
द रीजंस फॉर मेल इनफर्टिलिटी? बिकॉज़ दैट इज अ बिग रीजन नाउडेज, यू नो, अ मैटर ऑफ कंसर्न फॉर स्पेशली द मैरिड पीपल.
वेरी वेरी ट्रू. In particular, because male infertility is on rise, and you may be asking what is the incidence and the prevalence of the male infertility, and what is the scenario in the current situation, and in particular with the effect of the COVID on the male infertility. If you remember, we had a talk on the prevalence of the infertility, which is approximately 10 to 15%. Of the population are suffering from the infertility. Amongst those couples who are having infertility, about 1/3 of them are having problem with the male factor. And amongst these 1/3, basically 10 to 12%, they will have absolutely no sperm, which is called azoospermia. Now, with the impact of the COVID, the answer, the question is whether it is increasing male infertility. The answer is yes. It is also having a damaging effect on the spermatogenesis and therefore the male count, because they all, you know, the patient with the COVID, they will have fever, and this fever by itself, it will harm and damage the spermatogenesis, even the virus also. And there are now research indicating that if COVID comes at least 2-3 times, then definitely it will cause oligospermia. The other question, which is very often I have been asked, why the male infertility is on rise, and what are the reason, and is it the genetic or is what? Basically, it is male chromosome is a very unstable chromosome, and there are a lot of scientific research and evidence-based medicine which is showing that the genes which are responsible for the spermatogenesis on the long arm of the Y chromosome is being disappearing. So you can imagine this, either is this the part of an evolution, or is part of, is because of the mutation, or is because of the harming effect of the pesticide and xenoestrogen and the pollution and environmental pollution. It is the impact of all together, we can say. So suppose our grandfather, they had a normal sperm count of 100 million and more. Now, this generation in this present situation is 1/10 of what is that. If a man come to us with being anxious for a baby with his wife, and then if we check that he has got 20 million count, I think that we should be happy. Because now even the WHO criteria has been changed in 2010, where the normal concentration of the semen is being about 14 million per ml with 24 to 30% of the motile sperm, both active and progressive motility, it will be around 30 to 40%. And now the WHO, the criteria about the morphology is telling 4% normal morphology is enough to label a semen as a okay, as a normal. And anything, suppose abnormal sperms are more and normal morphology is less, then it is being labeled as less. And the count and the motility also is, if it is less than 14 million and the motility active sperms are less than 20%, so it is called oligoastenospermia, where the treatment remain including in the ART intrauterine insemination. But if it is a severe oligoastenospermia, which is below 5 million per ml, then they have to go for some kind of ART, that is assisted reproductive technique, not by conventional IVF, but by the intracytoplasmic sperm injection. The other things which is now maybe you will be asking about azoospermia, what about those patients who are having no sperm count, What do they do? Approximately 50% of the patients with absolutely no sperm azoospermia, they will have a non-obstructive azoospermia. 50% they have a obstructive azoospermia. So I will define and elaborate more. A patient come to us with the azoospermia and no sperm count. It is a must for us to do the testicular biopsy. And testicular biopsy, it indicates that yes, spermatogenesis is intact and spermatozoa present. Then easily they can go for ICSI, which gives a success rate of almost 40-50%. But if the testicular biopsy shows no spermatogenesis, not there, or it shows the basically the maturation arrest, or it shows the testicular atrophic changes in the testicular testicular biopsy, then it means non-obstructive azoospermia. And although the literature shows multiple biopsy and doing a ICSI, but still I am very doubtful and I don't think it is true. For how long we have to just do the testing, and what is the interval? Yes, the thing is, if we do the sperm count and the semen analysis today, we have to give 6 to 8 weeks time for the spermatogenesis to repair and get better. And after 6 to 8 weeks, we have to repeat. We have to again repeat the testing, and then if the second test also it indicates that azoospermia is dead, then it is a bad news, and we have to share with the husband and inform him about the report.
So reasons like, is it, you know, because of the present diet people are maintaining, or, you know, gym and all, because people are taking protein?
Yes, we have published the data on the seafood eaters, where it is basically seafood eaters versus the non-seafood eaters, and this data has been published in Fertility and Sterility, and it indicates that this work, which is done for almost 5 years at Mahavir Hospital, and then we found that yes, there is a lot of difference between the seafood eater and non-seafood eater. They have a better quality semen, better motility in patient with a non-seafood eater, because the thing is, the seafood, the sea fish, whatever is there, their pesticide collection will be there, and this pesticide is not allowed to be taken this fish or other seafood by a pregnant lady, because it will affect the male infertility. Even for the female also, maybe in future it can cause endometriosis. More and more research is required.
So seafood is not suggestible.
Seafood, it is sweet, like water fish, like marel fish, all those things are fine.
Okay. So what about the gym, like, you know, present youth, they all are like, you know.
Yes. Genetically, yes, it is azoospermia sometimes in it runs in the family, associated with the cystic fibrosis and Carthaginer syndrome. It is also there is, and also there is just unexplained, it can happen unexplained, that is, I told you, disappearance of the spermatogenetic gene in the Y chromosome. So it can be as a part of the mutation or as a part of the evolution. Or maybe occupational hazard, where if she had any pregnant lady exposure, radiation or X-ray radiation, all those can affect the male fetus, which subsequently can give rise to the male infertility.
So doctor, like people taking this extra protein while working out, or, you know, way, like fat burner to cut down their fat.
Obesity also, yes, obesity also, because in obese men, the conversion of the male hormone will be to an estrogen, female estrogen, and this estrogen can suppress the spermatogenesis. So they will have impotence, sexual impotence. They will also have other sexual problems, premature ejaculation, and they will also have a basically reduced spermatogenesis and oligospermia. So whenever obese men come to us, it is a must to check their thyroid and other hormone, LH and FSH. And it is a must to give them a weight reduction program and also gym before we embark on any other treatment.
Okay. So do you think present diet, like, you know, people eating junk nowadays is a reason also?
It matters a lot because, again, matter of the calorie and lack of the vitamins, especially vitamin C, is very important. Vitamin C is like oxygen reducing agent, and it increases the basically the fertilizing potential, and also the DNA fragmentation reduces. DNA fragmentation is another problem. We may have a husband semen totally a normal count, totally a normal motility, but then fertilization does not happen. It's because of the DNA fragmentation happens, and this DNA fragmentation, it is a very important aspect of our day-to-day practice, dealing with this male infertility patient, where this DNA fragmentation, the treatment possibilities, oxygen reducing agent, cold water bath, leptin, you know, tomato soup, vitamin C, lot of fruits, all those things matters a lot.
Is IVF the only treatment for this, like, if there is no possibility through all the medication and all?
No, it is 100% male infertility. It is basically if the count is less than 10 to 5 million, or let's say less than 5 million, ART is the only solution. Only one factor can help these men with a very low count is their wife's age. And if the wife age is basically very young, and she is below 25 years, so the wife age, when it is she is below 25 years, so because she is highly fertile, it can compensate for such a great reduction in semen.
Okay.
And concentration, and it can give rise to pregnancy, as we see day to day in our practice. But with the older wife, then matter become very complicated.
Mm-hmm.
Because with the older wife, she will also have some extent and some degree of the female infertility and ovulation problem. And when she get married to a man with an infertility problem, so that give rise to an infertility problem. And then they should go for some kind of either IUI or internal cytoplasmic sperm injection.
Okay. Thank you so much, doctor, for your valuable time. So people, if you have any suggestions or any doubts, anything, you can post it in the comments, or any, you know, consultation thing, you can just come down to Dr. Uyarozati in Banjara Hills, and she will give you the best treatment. So thank you so much again, ma'am, for your time.